Good evening, and welcome to the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation's 15th annual Frank K. Kelly Lecture on Humanity's Future. This is the first in a three-part lecture series that the foundation is going to conduct here at the Faulkner Gallery over the next couple of months. I want to thank the principal sponsor of this event, which is the Santa Barbara Foundation, for their generosity in helping us make this happen. And I also want to thank those of you who have given your support to the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation over the past three decades or more. And for those of you who are new to foundation activities, we do have an information table, I guess just outside the door, but you can also find us online at wagingpeace.org. Looking to the future requires us to take a hard look at our past and present. And when it comes to issues of war, peace, truth, and the media, our record as a country has not been admirable or even decent. In my lifetime, our political leaders have lied us into at least two wars, those in Vietnam and Iraq. And our mainstream media has often furthered the rush to war rather than support international law and the sanctity of peace. Let me say a few words about Frank Kelly, for whom this lecture is named, this annual lecture. He was a co-founder of the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation and served as its senior vice president from its founding in 1982 until Frank's death in 2010 at the age of almost 96. His life spanned most of the 20th century and intersected with some of the most important people and issues of our time, his time. In creating the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation, Frank and I shared a belief that peace is an imperative of the nuclear age. Peace is no longer just desirable. It is essential if we are to have a human future. Frank was a journalist, a soldier during World War II, a speechwriter for Harry Truman, an assistant to the Senate Majority Leader, and Vice President of the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions. The center is where Frank and I met, and where he also met Robert Scheer. Frank believed that everyone deserves a seat at humanity's table. He believed in democracy and in the inherent value of every person. He believed, in short, in humanity's future and that humanity deserved a glorious future, as Frank would have put it. He believed and shared this vision that we can shape a more promising future for our planet and its inhabitants. Our lecturer tonight, Robert Scheer, is, in my view, and that of many others, one of our country's most distinguished journalists. He speaks truth to power. In the 1960s, he was a Vietnam War correspondent, managing editor, and editor-in-chief of Ramparts magazine. In the 1970s through the early 1990s, he was a correspondent for the Los Angeles Times and launched a nationally syndicated column that is now based at truthdig.com. Truthdig.com is an internet website, a news website, that he founded in 2005, and where he currently serves as editor-in-chief. The title of Mr. Scheer, one more thing to say about him. He's also a professor of clinical communications at USC's Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism. Among his many books are With Enough Shovels, Reagan, Bush, and Nuclear War, and The Five Biggest Lies Bush Told Us About Iraq. The title of Mr. Scheer's lecture tonight is War, Peace, Truth, and the Media. This is a topic of considerable importance for obvious reasons, but particularly since no war in the nuclear age is trivial and nuclear weapons are lurking in the background at all times. If the stance of the media toward war is docile and deferent to authority, this helps support war and defeat peace. On the other hand, if the media finds and reports the truth, war is less likely to be embraced. And the media, I would say, is particularly important in this election year when so much untruth seems to be passing for truth and firm positions that are being set forth by presidential candidates, but not necessarily true positions. America needs more journalists like Robert Scheer, and we are very proud at the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation to have him as our lecturer tonight for the annual Kelly Lecture on Humanity's Future. So, Bob.
I feel like I showed up at the wrong place and you're waiting for another speaker. This is really quite terrific. Usually I'm down at USC speaking to a skeptical crowd of students who want to know if I can help them get a job. But anyway, I really do appreciate you turning out. I want to say I have great respect for the work that David and his wife Carol have done. I've gone to a few of their dinners when they honored Stanley Scheinbaum and Daniel Ellsberg and others. And I think that one of the dangers of the current moment is that we've lost sight of the ultimate threat. And as someone who, I think I was the first print journalist into Chernobyl a year after, and just the fear that the scientists that I went in with had about what was supposed to be the peaceful use of nuclear power and how many unknowns there was and how intimidating and frightening it was, reminds us of this danger. And the idea that we're messing around in our foreign policy with Russia and putting a stick in the eye of the Russian bear and it's all some kind of game is really quite depressing. And, you know, the weapons exist. There are, 90 of them in Pakistan. They have the means of delivery. And so, but everybody in this election, they treat about it as like a minor issue. We'll tear up the agreement with Iran, or we'll play tough, we'll level Syria and so forth. So in thinking about this lecture, I was thinking about how the wisdom of our founders, and I look at this topic. When I looked at this topic, I wanted to go back to sleep. War, peace, truth, and the media. And then how do you make sense of it? How do you wrestle it into some comprehension? And I think there is a way. I think we can return to the wisdom of the founders. I know it's not fashionable to celebrate the founders. Yeah, they're a bunch of cranky old white guys. And some of them had slaves, terrible, and some of them had wooden teeth and so forth. And we've had a lot of revisionist history about it, and it's warranted. It's important to examine. But there's an incredible wisdom that came out of this experiment. And the key to it, I think, was these guys were sitting there by candlelight. They still had books. They had been fairly well educated, most of them, and trying to figure out how did they get to this where they were estranged from what they thought was the center of civilization, right? The government in England, king. And now why were they contemplating revolution? And then they had looked at world history. They were quite knowledgeable. And the great mystery to them is, why did all the attempts at building a fine civilization, Rome, you know, and then the French and Spanish and English and so forth, go awry? And I think the great wisdom of our founders was the recognition that you could not be an empire and a republic at the same time. And that goes really what is embodied in our title today. If you're going to be involved in conquest, if you're going to be involved in ordering the affairs of the world and being the policeman, no matter your original motives, which could be very high, no matter your intentions, you're going to mess it up. Self-interest will obtain. You will really not know who these people are. You will really not respect their culture, their complexity, their needs, and you will become, in fact, monsters. You will be destructive. And if you look at their letters, their writings, and so forth, that was the essential wisdom. And in a document, I know most of you probably are familiar with General Eisenhower's farewell address, but very few people seem to have ever read George Washington's farewell address. And that's another great general who had incredible wisdom. And George Washington had 8 years to really think about it, because he thought he was going to be one term. He consulted with quite a few of the other founders about what to say in this thing that was going to be posted. And how many of you have read George Washington's farewell? Shame on you. Everyone, that's going to be on the test. Okay, everyone go home and read it. And by the way, I've written some books after the ones that were mentioned. And for some reason, they told me in a library, you can't sell books. I'm like in The Death of a Salesman, you know, Willie Loman, going around with those bags of books, and your old clients have died, you know, the independent bookstores, they've gone out of business, so you sell them out of your car. And so I've written about four of them in the last 10 years. And so I brought them here just to remind myself that they exist. And they're actually quite interesting. The one is called The Pornography of Power, How Defense Hawks Hijacked 9/11 and Weakened America. And that really is about how, you know, I don't know if you recall, but at the time of 9/11, I could read from the book, but Donald Rumsfeld gave an amazing speech 2 days before 9/11 in the Pentagon. And he said, you know, the Cold War is over. It's time to cut the defense budget. The first President Bush had, after all, talked about immediately cutting it by one-third. What do you need? All these expensive weapons and so forth. Communism is over as a expansionist power, international and so forth. And Rumsfeld gave a speech, said, but the world is beset with a great enemy. And then he went through the list. He said, yes, we have this enemy of this, but they're different and they're defanged. And the terrorists, yeah, they're fragmented. And he said, the real enemy we face, he said, that is terrorizing the world, the big problem, is our building, the Pentagon. That was Donald Rumsfeld. And he said, it's out of control. Our computers don't know what they're doing. We don't talk to each other. It's totally irrational. Very, very radical speech. Far more radical than anything David has ever offered, or even Daniel Ellsberg. And it prompted me to write this book. And then, as the saying goes, 9/11 changed everything. Right? It really didn't. We've always had terrorism. We've always had people using relatively primitive means to confront, challenge states of power, whether it's the Chechens, whether it's, you know, Al-Qaeda, what have you. That's a real problem. Civilians become the target and so forth. But it was not a fundamental change. But it became an excuse for revving up the Cold War. And it became an excuse for funding a whole range of very modern weapons, including nuclear modernization, that had nothing to do with going after people in caves fairly underdeveloped countries. A totally irrational exercise. And it bears witness to the wisdom of Washington, that once you get into these foreign adventures, once you have these enemies, and usually they're enemies of your own creation, you know, it's like in 1984, you have to have these enemies and they're interchangeable. You've all read 1984, right? And, you know, so you have to have an enemy, and sometimes this one, and sometimes it's that one, and so forth. And then that becomes the excuse for building up your military-industrial complex and your jingoism and your super patriotism. And as I say, Washington warned us about that. And every time I go back and I quote it, I think I made it up. So I then have to research it. And fortunately, these days, it's easier to research. And so I'll just read a couple of sentences here. But what he said is, you know, he said, and he was not an isolationist. He cared about the world. All of them did. They were interested. Obviously, Ben Franklin was even interested in the women all over the world. And, you know, they were not hicks. Quite smart, sophisticated, but they were talking about not isolationism and difference, they're talking about the military option, they're talking about power. And he said, our true policy, this is quoting his farewell address, to steer clear of permanent alliances with any portion of the foreign world, taking care always to keep ourselves by suitable establishments on a respectably defensive posture. Okay? He called for, instead of isolationism, he called for a vision of peaceful international relations. He said, quote, harmony, liberal intercourse with all nations are recommended by policy, humanity and interest. But even our commercial policy should hold an equal and impartial hand, neither seeking nor granting exclusive favors or preferences, consulting the natural course of things, diffusing and diversifying by gentle means. This is a general. By gentle means, the streams of commerce, but forcing nothing. And then he gave this sentence, which I think should be on every wall poster. In offering you, my countrymen, these counsels of an old and affectionate friend, to moderate the fury of party, to warn against the mischiefs of foreign intrigue, to guard against the impostures of pretended patriotism. Okay, can you think of a better phrase to describe the madness of not just the last 10 years, but the last 50 years, since the beginning of the Cold War? To guard against the impostures of pretended patriotism. And the fact that we're not more familiar with these warnings tells you something about the state of the media and the relation to the war machine. And so let me then go back to actually my talk that I prepared. I'll give you my other books. I have one on why the economy collapsed, the great American stick-up, how Reagan Republicans and Clinton Democrats enriched Wall Street while mugging Main Street. Has some relevance to the election now and what Bernie Sanders is saying. And then the one on the surveillance state, they know everything about you. Okay, so I won't quote anymore from that. So let me say something about this Frank Kelly lecture. I was a happy graduate student in Berkeley. And at one point, I saw a sign. I went back to City College, where I had been an undergraduate student, mostly studying engineering. And I went back to teach one summer, and I saw a little sign said that if you went to Cuba and you could get yourself to Cuba, this was the summer of 2000. The Cuban Revolution had happened 16 months before. And you could go there for $25 a week or something. And my wife at the time, sorry, Nard, I have to, my current wife of only 40 years, so we're just getting to know each other. By the way, Nard Zucchino is the associate editor of the LA Times for 33 years in different positions and gave us the LA Times Book Festival and wrote some very important books, so why don't you stand up? Wrote a very important book with the mother of Pat Tillman, the football player who volunteered there in the Rangers and was killed in Afghanistan. So maybe she could answer some questions. But anyway, I went at that time, saw the sign, went down to Key West, my little 56 Volkswagen, got over there and was in Cuba, first of quite a number of visits, and came back and realized this was the embargo was put in. We had an embargo against Cuba. Why? They had the crime of nationalizing their power plant and moving against some big sugar holdings and so forth. And suddenly that was considered much more dangerous than Batista. And by the way, Castro, who I ended up interviewing about 8 years later, Castro at that time was really a Catholic radical. And he would have been quite happy with the current pope, who was the person who brought about the peace. Because after all, Castro was a bit of a puritanical figure, not a Puritan, but they were offended by the corruption of Havana, and the gangsterism, and what Batista represented, and so forth. And really, the Cuban Revolution was mostly, certainly a non-communist, even anti-communist revolution. The Communist Party in Cuba didn't support it, even somewhat until 6 months before the revolution succeeded, and they were just considered these wild young products of Catholic education who took it seriously about the poor and all that stuff. And it is fitting that it took, finally, Ramparts, which was mentioned, by the way, was created in response to Pope John and his patrimonterus, finally, we have another pope to pick up that cause, and that's the pope that helped bring about recognition of Cuba. So we've had some real progress in the last few years. I'm not going to say anything about Hillary Clinton, but I will say that John Kerry is a far better Secretary of State, and he's actually been able to move on a much more peaceful agenda. So it shows you why you need white men in power. Particularly ones who fought in Vietnam and then turned against the war and did all the things he did. He's finally returned to his roots as a younger person. But I do see, I'm not going to end up bumming everybody out. I see actually some real signs of progress in the world. I think the agreement with Iran is very positive. I think if we can bring Russia back into the attempt to get some stop killing civilians in Syria and some stability there. So we can talk about that in the question period and everything. But my point in bringing up Cuba at that time is that we, of course, got it all wrong. And we decided somehow this was a great enemy. And when I got back, I teamed up with another guy, Maurice Seitlin, who ended up then going to Princeton. And then he was at UCLA, and we wrote a book that Penguin published. And as a result, I perished publishing, and I lost my fellowship in the Center for Chinese Studies because I was writing about Cuba and so forth. But I only bring that up because then, at that time, I realized something. You don't have adults watching the store. You could spend all your time making rational arguments about foreign policy and the facts and the logic and the implications and so forth, and at the end of the day, it doesn't mean diddly squat, okay? It doesn't mean a thing. Because interest, careerism, profit, you know, these things, the mischiefs of party intrigue and so forth, dominate. And people stop being adults. And they forget the consequence. They forget all the death, the destruction, the metal piercing skin, the babies killed, the whole thing. They just forget it. It becomes a video game even before we had video games, okay? And that has been my whole experience as a journalist. And it began with that trip to Cuba. I come back, I have an image. No, wait a minute, you may not like him, you may not cast him, but come on, Cuba is not a threat to American national security. I mean, it's absurd, you know, and no one could ever make that case any more than they could ever make it about Vietnam. And so, but nonetheless, it became this threat, and good people that we sort of have fond memories of now, like JFK, actually went to war. And, you know, all these years, we had to be totally irrational about it. And if you were the least bit rational, you were considered soft on communism or something else. And so I wrote a book at that time with Maurice. And then, as I say, I got pushed out of Berkeley. I mean, they took my money away. And so I went to work at City Lights Books for Lawrence Ferlinghetti. And while I was there, and my job, it's a great bookstore to this day, and I love Lawrence. By the way, I've done an interview recently with Lawrence, who's now 95 years old. And it's interesting, Lawrence Ferlinghetti was an anti-sub commander in World War II. And he had been in naval reserve and so forth. And he was in the invasion of Normandy. And then they shifted him to Japan. And in that capacity, and the war ended after the dropping of this bomb, the bombs, and Ferlinghetti was one of the first to actually witness the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And he said it made him an instant pacifist. And the reason he became, he went to the Sorbonne, got a doctorate, and wrote, and the reason he became a beat poet, and the reason he became a rebel in his own society was largely over that experience. I just throw that in as a little footnote. So anyway, when I lost my fellowship, I went and worked for Lawrence for a buck and a quarter an hour at City Lights Books. And one of the nice things is Lawrence let us take our books home. Shouldn't probably tell you, but if you go there and you buy a book, it might have been read by a staff person who then returned it to the shelves. And I would clean the store in the morning, and then one of my jobs was to unwrap the books and so forth. So one day I'm there, and I still was connected with Berkeley, but I'm here to make a living. And I open up China Quarterly, and I'm open up Nouvelle Observatoire, the French publication, and I'm reading all this. And I'm the French and the British, right then, it was 1962, 63, are warning us about Vietnam. The Americans are making the same stupid mistake that the French made, okay? So I read all this stuff, and I get interested. And then I, at Berkeley, you know, great thing about stacks, and now people don't know about stacks. So I go up into the stacks there at the library, and I go into the Vietnam section to read a little bit more about it. And the great thing about stacks is, you know, only find the book you were looking for. I'm sure there are librarians here. They love this kind of talk. They always ask me out after and everything. Okay, but it's true. And libraries were just great places to hang out. And so I'm there in the stacks reading about Vietnam, and you know, I've got a little carol there and reading. And then I come across a little package of material. This is a long-winded way of telling you why I am honored to be here giving a Frank Kelly lecture. So I'm up there in the stacks, and there's a package with a ribbon around it, and there's dust on top. So I pull it down, I blow off the dust, unwrap it, and inside what had happened was one of the individuals in something called the Vietnam Project of Michigan State had died a natural death, and his widow had turned his papers and books over to the Cal Library. And I opened these papers, and these were discussion about torture. And it was discussion about training the police of South Vietnam. And it was discussion about preventing the Geneva Accords, which had mandated elections when the French were defeated at Dien Bien Phu. And there were supposed to be elections in 56, and how to prevent them, and how to build a government. Ngo Dinh Diem, a guy who had been in the Marino Seminary in New Jersey, and then we said he's the George Washington of his country, and put him in power after the French were defeated and prevented the Geneva elections from happening. And we made only one mistake. You can't take a guy from the Marino Seminary in New Jersey and make him the George Washington of Vietnam, because Vietnam was largely 90% Buddhist and didn't quite work out the way the CIA had planned. And I had actually interviewed old Colonel, then General Lansdale, about all this. So anyway, I got these piles, and I realized this is a project done by professors at Michigan State working on the police project. Michigan State, in addition to having a football team, had a police project. I don't want to insult anybody from Michigan State. You had a great football team. The police project wasn't so wonderful. It was a CIA front. You know, sort of thing still goes on all over the place. But and they were recruiting people and then sending them there to put up basically a military dictatorship. Okay, and I looked down. There's professors connected with it and so forth. And I decide that I'm going to investigate this. Thus is my investigative journalist career is born. And I go find these people. And, quite interesting. None of them, very few would talk to me. And then I find one of them, a guy who, hi. Funny. I realize I'm now old. And some of these old people are people I knew when I was young. Hey, we used to be in the playground together. Oh, so at any rate, I do this, and I find this guy, Stanley Scheinbaum. Any of you remember Stanley? He ran for Congress? Yay. So Stanley Scheinbaum was incapable of lying. It's just it. He loved to tell stories, and he had this great virtue. He just could not hold back on any story, you know, whether it was about where to get the best delicatessen or anything. He had stories. And so he had been the co-director of this project. And so I found him. Now this is project had been going on. He had been connected in 56, 57. Now we're in 63, 64. And I'm going around the country interviewing these people. And Stanley says, you're absolutely right. This thing has bothered me forever. I've looked into it. And he tells me the first story about my documents. They're real, and it was a CIA front, and he was the domestic co-director, and he was not, when he got to Vietnam, he couldn't even look in the building and talk to the people that he had recruited about what they were doing, and they were doing horrible stuff, okay? And by the way, if you want to know why there was one of the reasons that, you know, Daniel Ellsberg, when he was here, when you have the Pentagon Papers, you wonder why some people, you know, lots of people knew about what was in the Pentagon Papers, right? Knew the lies and everything. You know, the question is not why did Daniel Ellsberg do it? It's why didn't those tens of thousands of other people who knew this ever say a word? It's the same question about Edward Snowden. You don't have to sit around speculating about, you know, the autobiography of Edward Snowden. A lot of people had the same clearance as that 29-year-old guy. Why didn't they tell us the truth, including Dianne Feinstein and a whole bunch of other folks, Hillary Clinton, what have you? You know, so I just put that out there. So when I first met Ellsberg, and when he was going on trial and so forth, I met Tony Russo, who was his co-defendant. What Tony Russo had been doing at the RAND Corporation, where Daniel Ellsberg was also at that time, was evaluating the interrogation of prisoners in South Vietnam. And the reason he became Daniel Ellsberg's ally in revealing the papers he knew about the torture. Torture didn't start after 9/11. And he knew about, or enhanced interrogation. And he knew the terrible things we were doing and so on. That's why Daniel Ellsberg turned. Daniel Ellsberg was a hawk. Daniel Ellsberg, you know, had been in the Marines. He believed in all this. And then he saw the terrible things, the bombing and everything was done. Well, Tony Russo was more intimately involved. His job at RAND was reading these reports, and he was horrified the thing. So going back to Stanley had started to learn all this. And my first trip to Vietnam, I had been there. And I must say how I got to go was interesting because no journal, no paper, I didn't have ramparts yet. And I went to a great guy. I just got an email from him this morning. I'm sure he sent it to thousands of other people telling me I must see Michael Moore's new movie. You've seen it? Okay. I haven't seen it, but if Paul Krasner says I should see it, I'll see it. And Paul Krasner had a magazine called The Realist magazine. Does anybody remember The Realist? No. Okay, this goes to the question of the media. Remember, the title is War, Peace, Truth, and the Media. So I thought about this a lot the last week. And the title, and what do I have to really say about this? So the media then, you know, was not very good. There were a few people, Homer Bigot at the New York Times, much before David Halberstam. There were some, not many. Mostly the media was celebrating every aspect of the Cold War. And Paul Krasner got this great idea to sell fuck communism posters. Did any of you ever have one? Yeah. See? The children of Paul Krasner, rise, you know, and it's great. I remember certain moments from this whole period. I'm going to start rambling, but my rambling is interesting. Stick with me. You know, but I do remember a few moments of this sort of counterculture meets the anti-Vietnam War, and certainly Paul Krasner, but another one was Norman Mailer at the 1964 teach-in, which I helped organize. Did you help? You were just a little baby then. Yeah, Jimmy Farnham, who I knew from those. But anyway, that's when Norman Mailer gave a great speech. I think you can even get it on, not iTunes, but someplace. And this is a speech in which he said, Lyndon Johnson, it was late in the day, we'd had debates and the big Berkeley teaching. And he said, you know, Lyndon Johnson was reported by his colleagues as saying he never trusts a man unless he's got his pecker in his pocket. You heard that one? Important presidential statements. I never trust a man unless I have his pecker in my pocket. And so Norman Mailer made that the overriding theme of his speech about Vietnam. And his ultimate line was, what we have to do is turn Lyndon Johnson upside down and shake him so all those dead and near-dead peckers can fall to the ground and come back to life and jump up and down and everything. I thought it was a great image. It carried me through some of my darkest moments in life, freeing these dead peckers. And so anyway, the same thing in my own brain, which is not as good as it used to be, is the Paul Krasner's Fuck Communism poster. And it was brilliant because it had red, white, and blue stars. And so, remember, in those days, Lenny Bruce got arrested for saying fuck, right? You remember? And Days of Innocence, when no one did it or said it. And so Paul Krasner made a fortune off these things because kids could buy them, you know, and then what dorm head is going to say, no, you can't put up your fuck communism poster. You could tell this, what are you, some kind of traitor? Subversive? You know, so it was one of those great moments in literary history. So anyway, he made a lot of money off this, so I went to see Paul Krasner. I said, I got to go to this place called Vietnam and check out this thing I'm trying to do. And he said, well, where the hell is it? And I explained it. Well, that was true. I'm only bringing that up because that's the way most people felt. I mean, most people in America never know where these countries are that we invade, right? You know, or where they lose their children or whatever. They have to do catch up. And what was that place, honey? You know, he's not coming back from? I mean, this is the reality. And we don't care about their history. And we lose interest the day we're no longer killing them, right? Okay. I mean, we don't care about Vietnam now, right? We get our underwear from there. You know, they're fighting with China over shelf space at Costco. They're still communist countries. We don't care. We're not there. And so Krasner, I told him, and I told him how much I needed. I think it was $1,482 for a round-trip ticket. So he wrote out a check, and I went to Vietnam and part of checking on this. And then my break in this story came when I came back and I found Stanley Scheinbaum, and he returned with me to Vietnam. And he was a great guy, early whistleblower, and he felt awful about this. He had been researching himself. And his brother ran. This is the whole crazy thing about adults not watching the store. They don't look like the devil. They're not dripping blood. They present very well. Our killers always present well. McNamara, you ever met him? Thoroughly decent guy, cries in a minute. You say anything, cries. You ever saw the Fog of War movie? He cries, yeah? I mean, he doesn't cry over the 3.5 million he said were killed in China. He cries over the memory of Kennedy, but still he cries. And so I go there, and Stanley's brother was running 1/3 of Vietnam. He was in the Foreign Service, I don't know. I like Gil Scheinbaum, nice guy. But we stayed at his house. He brought over his maid, Mai. He said, Mai, you like the Americans here. Mai, of course, said, yes, we like the Americans here. That, you know, so echoes of the American South, how much you love segregation. And, you know, that was his view of the thing. And we went over into Cambodia as well, and Laos. And Stanley really, I know this has taken a long time, but it's an optimistic story. Stanley's the one who brought me down to the Center for Study of Democratic Institutions, okay? I basically had exposed Stanley. He then wrote the introduction to my study. He introduced me to Robert Hutchins and Frank Kelly, whose lecture I'm here to give today, and Harry Ashmore and the whole crowd, Henry Luce, Justice Douglas. It was quite a place. I've never been so intimidated as giving a lecture to that crowd. I thought I'd gone into a period of Greek history, but it was great, and I gave them my report. Now, I'd made several trips to Vietnam, and I'd done this study and everything, and blessed them. And this was a study that I'd done. I could not get published anywhere. And Robert Hutchins and Frank Kelly and that crowd, Paul Jacobs and others, they were all veterans of the war, and they all been around. They've been in Foreign Service. They've been in government. They were not the least bit naive, but at least they had the decency to not turn away from the facts. And they published my study, of which I have a copy. This is called How the United States Got Involved in Vietnam. And I don't want to wax too nostalgic here, but it was great. And I don't know the exact numbers. I noticed on this one, which I got on, I bought on Amazon. Get used books on Amazon, and I think it says, this was the 7th printing. Yeah, 8th printing, September 1970. So it kept being printed, and it was great, and it helped found a movement, okay? And so it is, you know, if I accomplish nothing else, it's a particular honor to honor a person who helped me at that stage, and that whole crowd. And they didn't always agree with me. I went and interviewed Chief Justice Douglas. He'd written a book called Far From Malaysia. He liked him. He'd met him. He celebrated him. And he called the police to throw me out of his office, great civil libertarian, but an arrogant one. And he didn't want to hear my questions anymore. It's not the first politician I've had that problem with. But anyway, you know, the fact is they printed it. And Robert Hutchins was a great man, just a great man. And that center was an incredible place. And so anyway, I did want to say that. But I also want to make another point, and that was the point David Halberstam made with this discussion of the best and the brightest. The fact is, the enemy is us. The enemy is our indifference, our span of attention, our limited knowledge, our indifference to the other, the very thing Jesus warned about in the Good Samaritan in Luke, forgetting that everyone has a soul. The Pope is reminding us that they're not collateral damage. They are human beings as significant as us, with the same hopes, aspirations, and so forth. And when you cover wars, and I think Chris Hedges, who writes for us, is one person who has grasped that maybe better than anyone, you tend to forget the humanity of the people that are being slaughtered. You're on this side, you have armor, you have protection, you're being briefed, you have inside information, and those people, what are they? You may not call them the gooks, but they're the gooks. They're the other. And in my experience, certainly nothing like Chris Hedges' experience, which is, you know, 20 years of covering war for the New York Times and others. So if people say to me, they read Truth Hedges on Truth Dig, probably the best thing I've ever done in my whole life is provide a publishing space for Chris Hedges after the New York Times pushed him out because he gave a speech at a college about the horror of the war in Iraq and based on lies. And people say to me, Chris Hedges, he's so angry and he's so pessimistic. I say, well, maybe if you covered war for 20 years, you get a little angry and pessimistic. And I remember during that war, you know, I went to North Vietnam as well, and I traveled around and south and everything. And, you know, we forget what carpet bombing is. I mean, you've seen the fog of war, right? And you can go back to World War II. We forget the implication, the concept. We just do. And right now, the same thing. You know, oh, we'll do this and so on. So the interesting thing about the point Washington is making, and let me move a little faster here, is that basically we have a great experiment here in our society in limited government, right? This is the basic notion. Limited vis-a-vis the king, limited and so forth. And checks and balances, division of power, and then sticking the Bill of Rights on. And the great heart of the whole experiment is that power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. No matter how they present, no matter what you say, and remember that the founders were giving us these protections and restraints on power, knowing that they were going to be the power, right? So after 9/11, we have a lot of discussion now, oh, everything changed, as if no other nation has ever been attacked, as if there's never been chaos, you know? Well, here we are sitting in the most secure, militarily powerful country that has ever existed, right? We have a military budget that is almost half of the whole world, equal to all the other nations combined. We have incredibly advanced modern technology, you know, drones, everything, stealth, everything else. We are in no way vulnerable to an overthrow by any foreign power, you know, and yet we are told, and that's as modern as the current controversy involving Apple and the FBI, we are told that we cannot afford these restraints on government power because we once again have a unique enemy. And an enemy so terrifying, so fearsome, that we have to throw those things aboard. And in the process, as in the war against communism, the Cold War, freedom is treated as a luxury, right? Freedom is something you can have when you have no danger. That's the line, right? We have to smash into cell phones now to find something about people who are dead who did the Riverside thing. And we know quite a bit about them. Most of what we know about them is why didn't they show up before, since you had them on your radar 25 different ways. And that's true of every single person you've had, whether it's the people who did the Boston bombing, or the people who did Charlie Hebdo, or the people who did Riverside. Every single time, they were on the radar. When Barack Obama tried to tell us that defend surveillance, the Surveillance Society, the 1984 Society. He had only one example where this surveillance needed. It was the 19th hijacker who was in San Diego. What he did not mention was that 19th hijacker was living at the home of an FBI informant, was well known to the FBI, had traveled with bona fide passport from Saudi Arabia, was known to the CIA, and nothing was done about him. Okay? And you didn't need to break into the telephone of every single person in the United States to find that. And that has been true in every single instance up to now. Okay? And yet, what are we told? Yes, you have a Fourth Amendment, but the Fourth Amendment is for people who were never threatened, right? Or people who didn't have modern technology. It's ironic with modern technology. We have never known so much about our people as we do now. Forget it about breaking into their cell phone. They voluntarily, right? They Yelp, you know? They Google. They give their location. All of us do all the time, right? No matter how paranoid we may be, we still do it because I got to find that restaurant that, you know, is a little bit cheaper and a little bit better and next to the movie theater. And okay, you can use my location. So we have a dictator's wet dream readily available to everybody in the world, not any government, you know. If you think about the old days when the FBI went out to destroy, you know, when you had the head of the FBI saying, we have to get Apple. You know, Apple is helping the criminal and everything. Does anybody remember that this is the same FBI that went out to kill Martin Luther King? That you know, but yet, what the means they had? They had to get a hotel room next to his. They had to physically follow him, right? They had to break into phone lines. Very primitive, okay? And when Sullivan and Deke DeLoach, I could tell you my Deke DeLoach stories, it's another speech. But when these guys who were working with Hoover wrote the letter telling King to commit suicide, you know, the fake letter and telling you evil ape-like person, blah, 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 they had very primitive means. Now, you can do anything. All this information is available and you can make up stories, make up narratives, plant data, change the records, do anything you want. Drive people crazy, monitor their every motion. You can tell what book they bought. Did you buy 1984 or Shades of Grey, 50 Shades of Grey? How far did you read in it? Did you get Lady Chatterley's Lover After, or did you get the Communist Manifesto? How far did you read in that? What did you write? What did you say to her? Well, that's available. And yet they tell us it's not enough. Not enough. So no government has ever been stronger and ever had more power to observe its enemies, be they foreign or domestic. Never, okay? Contract everybody, kill everybody, do everything. Yet they tell us, and the protections that we were given by our founders are naive, befitting a simpler time. Think about it. Here were the founders in this incredibly weak society they created, up against the major powers of the world, right? Powers that would return and want to hang them from the nearest tree. Right? The same, you know, Brits that come to sack Washington, right? Burn it, you know? So they know they're up against all of them. You can't trust any of them, the Germans, the French, the Spanish, the English, and so forth and so on. And yet, they enshrine these protections against government, again, based on the idea that all governments will lie. Going back to the theme of the lecture, all governments will deceive you. And particularly if they get into foreign adventure, foreign entanglements. Consistent theme. Therefore, the citizenry has to be empowered. Why? Because the basis of this new experiment in representative government depends on informed citizenry. The citizenry is not informed, as I told my students last night when I lost my cool, and I love my students, I love the school, I think we got great students, and the excitement of teaching is if you can get them the least bit interested, 3 days later, they know not only more than their parents, they know more than their professor. I mean, they have all the tools, they can check original documents, say, come up, they don't quite say I'm full of shit, but they think it. And, you know, so, okay, you can have a good dialogue then. But I got really pissed off last night because, as I said to my students, who are graduating in 7 weeks, and they're good. They have high SAT scores. They went to fine schools. We have fine professors. And I asked them, I said, you know, we have this whole problem now of Apple doesn't want to give up this information. Why? Because Apple's main business model is to sell multinationally, particularly in China. And if they let the NSA and the FBI get into the back of their phones, how are they going to say no to the Chinese? How are they going to say no to Egypt, right? How are they going to say, so if you're a multinational company, you have to be true to your consumers everywhere, okay? And there are more cell phones, smartphones now in China than the population of the United States. And that's the growth model. So, and that's why Google pushes back, you know? That's why Instagram pushes back, Facebook pushes back, because multinational corporations cannot betray their customers all over the world with this abandon that the FBI is asking. But I ask my students, here we're in this crazy world. China is still run by a communist party, and yet they've underwrite our debt. They are now the second largest economy, soon to be the first. They are a major trading partner. Apple and Google, their whole future is dependent upon selling something to them, and yet they're still treated as an enemy. And so I asked my student, I said, does anybody remember how we came to have peace with China? No. Anybody remembers Nixon's visit to China? No. Okay? And I'm, again, not putting down my students. I'm putting down the educational system. I'm putting down the SAT. Look, oh, you don't know about that? No? Okay. I said, do you remember the time or know anything about the time when we were at war with China physically, Chinese communists, shooting them, they're shooting us? No. No. Except one kid in my class who is from China. She says, yes, the Korean War. Oh, I asked my students, you know anything about the Korean War? No. What was it? Wasn't on the SATs, okay? Doesn't exist, non-history, okay? And then you look at, and if an informed public is the basis to make representative democracy meaningful, that goes to this whole question of the media, so forth. So let me say, our ignorance is informed, once again, by a grand mythology that has no basis in reality, okay? And the period that I was describing before, in the period of the Cold War, was based on a fiction that a large number of educated people knew was outrageously wrong. And that was the idea of a monolithic international communism driven by some readings from Marx and Lenin that was inherently expansionist, inherently aggressive, right? And inherently anti-nationalist. It didn't matter if they were Russian, Chinese, Vietnamese, or so forth. What they were doing had nothing to do with their history. Ho Chi Minh could not be seen as a nationalist the way Eisenhower described him in Mandate for Change when he said Ho Chi Minh would have gotten 80% of the vote in any fair election, right? No, he's a communist. He's beholden to the Chinese and through them to the Russians. It's monolithic, it's undifferentiated, and so forth. Smart people accepted this is true, right? It was not challenged. Yet, the Sino-Soviet dispute preceded the Chinese communists coming to power. The Chinese communists were shooting at Russian communists back in the late 20s. It was an absurd notion. Chinese nationalism under communists was advanced. The whole thing was a nationalist movement. So was Vietnamese communism. So was what we now call Cuban communism. All nationalist movements. There weren't, at the time of the Vietnam War, two communist countries in the world that were on decent speaking terms. I know, I traveled in these countries, okay? If you read Khrushchev's memoir, you read any of the literature that was widely available to people who are supposed to be scholars, journalists, experts, you know, the whole thing was a tissue of lies. That doesn't mean you like them. Doesn't mean you endorse it as a better civilization. Doesn't mean you believe in that model. But the idea that you will treat them as if they don't have nationalist aspirations, right, and that they're just part of some common term, was absurd, right? China had occupied Vietnam for 1,000 years, right? You know, think about it now. They're fighting about some islands, right? You know, think of the tension between Russia and China, and so it doesn't mean they can't make trade deals, which they're doing, because they're increasingly acting as capitalists. But the whole notion that so much of our history was driven by this, and for me as a kid, I remember it vividly. That's why I'm here now, still hocking away. My father happened to be a German, okay, a German farm boy, Protestant. My mother happened to be a Russian Jew from Lithuania. And they met on a picket line in New York. And as sex and love will take its way, they got together and produced me. And unfortunately, for the scheme of things, my father had another family. And so I was raised on something called home relief. one of the reasons I'm not so sympathetic to welfare reform and of the kind that Bill Clinton instituted. Well, I'll get that to another speech. But I remember growing up, I was born in 36, and so I went through this period, and we had German relatives arriving all the time from Germany, and I spoke German and played soccer, and they were nice to me. And I had Jewish relatives who were telling increasing tales of woe and so forth. And after the war, I went back, found my German relatives, found my father's brother who was wounded at Stalingrad in the German army many times, many conversations, German. I could not find any of my Jewish relatives. They were all dead. So I went through this whole thing. And as a kid, we played games. So I played a game, killing Krauts. That's what you did, right? We're killing Krauts, you know, or killing Japs, you know, Nips or whatever. And well, my father was a Kraut, okay? So we go through this whole thing, and I'm struggling with it, you know, struggling with other questions too, like why did the Italian kids, I'm married to one of them now, keep punching me in the nose and saying I killed their lord? I would try to inform them that only half of me killed your lord. Unfortunately, when I was yet at Ramparts, the Pope decided we hadn't killed, the half of me anyway, had not killed the Lord, so I got off on that one. But there, you know, even in the war, you still had your traditional prejudices and everything. And then an amazing thing happened. The war ended, and the Krauts became our allies. You're probably old enough, some of you, to remember that. And suddenly, you know, if you read David Talbot's great book that we were discussing at dinner, you'll see Alan Dulles, our top spy, was out there, the brother of John Forrest Dulles, recruiting all these Nazis to come work for us and everything else while the war was even going on, because the real plan was to have the Germans knock off the Russians and the Bolsheviks and so forth. And so you have this playing with power. There's a total disconnect between what the public is told and what. And suddenly, and this, you know, I'm a kid, I'm now, what, 9, 8, 9, 10 years old, and suddenly, wait a minute, you know, and my mother, you know, when she would try to get me to eat my vegetables, right, and that and keep the dessert, okay, she'd tell me the dessert was the Russians, you know, and the spinach were the Germans, you know, and broccoli were the Italians, you know, and, right, and squash were the Japanese. So let's destroy them first before you get to the dessert. That changed overnight. Boom. No, it's all different, the communist myth. So you have what you have now. You had the development of this mythology, which is just like you get in 1984. You have the enemy of choice. And everybody signs on. Everybody. Smart people, educated people, people who know 9 languages, people who've traveled everywhere. They all sign on, with very few exceptions. And you punish people. You go after them. You have witch hunts. You throw some of them in jail who disagree with that narrative. Okay? And what is amazing to me is, having gone through all of that, A, we still don't ask any questions about what it was all about. Right? Because after all, think of the ability of, they call it social science, to predict. If you read any of the smart people, if you listen to any of the smart people, what were they saying? There's a domino theory. Right? We lose in Vietnam. Right? Echoes, we don't win in Iraq, we don't win in Syria. We lose in Vietnam, we'll have to fight him here, right? And by inference, it was China, it was Russia, right? Because the Vietnamese couldn't get here, didn't have the technology. But that was accepted. You have neighbors, right, who believe that, right? Some of them told you they even had top clearances, had secret briefings, knew everything, okay? Exactly the opposite happened. What did happen, by the way, when we suffered the most ignominious defeat in American history, which was Vietnam? People lifted off the roofs of the building next to the embassy and the embassy. All these terrible things, terrible human suffering and everything. What happened militarily? Does anybody know the one sentence answer on a multiple choice question? Who went to war? Red China and Red Vietnam. Boom. Exactly the opposite of what people have been saying for all the years of the war. Exactly the opposite, okay? Now, if somebody's doing a scientific experiment, right, they have a hypothesis, and it turns out to be exactly wrong, the war didn't bubble, it froze, you have to revise your theory, right? I mean, isn't that what we all believe? Yet you haven't heard any of these Cold Warriors who then became neoconservatives. Then there any of them, Madeleine Albright, who I first met when she was working for Scoop Jackson, the person who said that any woman who doesn't support Margaret Thatcher deserves a special place in hell. I've modified the statement a little bit, but, right? I met Madeleine Albright when she was working for Scoop Jackson, the senator from Boeing, with Richard Pearl. I go back a long way with these folks, you know? Did anybody ever ask Madeleine Albright what you learned from all that? You know? And why didn't you apply it when you got to be Secretary of State to a complex world and so forth? Does anyone ever think about it? And what was the terrible consequence for us from a national security point of view when, as I said before, you got Communist China and Communist Vietnam, what is their main battle now, fighting over shelf space at Costco, right? Do you buy socks from one or the other? And so, you know, the disconnect between reason, thought, study, adulthood, right, being solemn, and the consequence is startling. Now, Robert Hutchins, when I met him, and some of the folks at Center, that's what they were all about. Let's not have that disconnect. Let's think it through. Let's be original. That was their great contribution. But they were so rare, you know, as well as his contribution, you ought to read great books and you ought to stop to think and so forth, you know. But we don't have that. So you have people, and again, as I say, if it didn't carry over the war on terror, then you could say, okay, Bob, enough. We went through a dark period called the Cold War. It was rife with stupidity and irrationality. And a lot of people got killed that shouldn't have to have had, and so forth. So give us a new speech. The reason I'm giving you this speech is because it applies to the so-called war on terrorism exactly. Exactly. There's no study of history. There's no recognition of complexity. Okay? Let's just take a few examples of this. And it's embraced by the media generally, and embraced by the wise people and the best and the brightest and so forth. You had an attack on the World Trade Center, okay? 15 of the 19 hijackers come from Saudi Arabia. Let's just take that fact. You're a cop here in Santa Barbara, and you're trying to figure out why that glass got busted on the store. And somebody gives you a fact. 15 of the 19 people involved in this gang are from a place called Saudi Arabia. Maybe you would, and they were traveling on legal passports, okay? And they were not suspicious in their own society. You might ask a question about Saudi Arabia's role in this break-in in the Santa Barbara Walgreens or something. You might. No one did, okay? The head of the bloody thing, bin Laden, right, is a product of Saudi society. He's playing upon a religious variant of Islam, right? Wahhabism, that happens to be sponsored by these people, teacher center. I don't want to go through the whole bleary history, okay? And he ends up in Afghanistan. Why is it? You want to cut me off 5 minutes? Okay. I have only another 2 hours. Okay, let me then wrap it up much faster. You know, this is the problem writers have. Most of the time, you're alone with yourself and you're a very boring person. And most of the time, the material you're reading is not all that exciting and interesting, right? And then you get a rare occasion to tell you people what you discovered, and sometimes they're my captive audience and my students, and they have to sit there until the attendance sheet goes around. But you don't have to, so let me try to be a little bit more, be quick with this. But the fact of the matter is, it's the same disconnect between reason, logic, and fact that we have now, because, okay, no one goes back. How did these nuts get to be in Afghanistan? Afghanistan was not a terribly irrational place, right? It was not a center of wild, mad Islamic extremism. They were there because, right, remember Zbigniew Brzezinski's famous interview with Nouvel Observateur? You don't. That's where he said that we wanted to give the Russians their Vietnam, the Soviets their Vietnam, and that's why we backed the Mujahideen, the freedom fighters that Reagan celebrated, but it started under Jimmy Carter with Zbigniew Brzezinski, and then we helped them recruit. There weren't enough lunatics in Afghanistan, homegrown. We had to recruit them from the rest of the world and bring them there and support them, right? And then Zbigniew Brzezinski said, "What's you want to compare a few riled up Muslims with, you know, defeating the Soviets?" And, I mean, that's his reasoning in the Cold War. We taught them. Okay, so these are monsters of our own creation. And instead of tracking that, right, we pick a fight with people who had nothing to do with it. The one place in the Sunni world where you could clearly say al-Qaeda could not operate was Iraq. Clearly, Saddam Hussein, having the tenacity of a vicious dictator, would hunt these people down because he thought they were crazy and a threat to him. You know, he couldn't operate. It had nothing to do with it. No one's ever come up with a shred of evidence. Forget about the weapons of mass destruction. Nothing to do with it. And so, okay, you overthrow him. Again, that undifferentiated thing, oh, they're all Muslims. Well, what do you replace Saddam Hussein with? A different group of Muslims, right, who happen to not get along with that group, but they happen to be based in Iran, the other place, center of evil, right? They were there in exile, they were supported by Iran, and they happen to represent a majority in Iraq. So you get exactly the opposite of the outcome you expected or intended, and you now have created a very strong base of support for Iran, so it can't be easily isolated, and that's one of the reasons you had to make peace with Iran, right? They're too big a player, and you made them a bigger player. You gave them stability. They won, by the way. They won. The Ayatollah won, okay? I happen to favor the agreement and so forth, but the fact of the matter is this whole policy of isolating them and saving has failed. So now what you've done is create a situation in the Middle East where you have a genuine civil war based on religion going throughout the whole region. That's what ISIS is, right? That's what the destruction of Syria and everything. And Libya, oh, you got a defanged dictator in Libya, you replace him. The problem is the same, going back to the question that I was raised to, told to deal with. What was that question? Yes. War, peace, truth, and the media. The media is impotent to deal with it, the truth, finding the truth. I can go through all the reasons for that, but never so much as now when their business model is broken. And we can have a lively discussion. When the LA Times had a monopoly, when the New York Times had a monopoly in this region, they could indulge the truth every once in a while. They could take some risks. They could do the work. They could pay the bills. Now they're panicked. The reason that the New York Times and the LA Times collapse in the face of this irrationality of invading Iraq, they were afraid they'd be out of step with their readers. They were afraid they would lose them. And so they caved. And the economic basis of their integrity is gone. That's just a reality. And we don't have much money for covering these things. We don't have much interest and so forth. So that's number one. Number two is you have very big interests in your society that benefit from killing people around the world. You still have a military-industrial complex. It ramps up very quickly. They were desperate. You know, to first Reagan had betrayed them when he embraced Gorbachev. And then people blame that on Alzheimer's. I wish all our presidents had Alzheimer's. I mean, seriously, if you think the denigration of Reagan is over the sensible things he did at the end, not the stupid things he did when he's supposed to have had all his brains. But nonetheless, you are in exactly the same trap as you was before. However, it's more dangerous. Because at least in the Cold War, there were nation states you could deal with. There were records that could be compiled. There were negotiations that can take place. Now you have the totally undifferentiated, invisible enemy, and you can describe it as unified, a constant threat, right? And it can always be summoned. And it will always give some physical manifestation of its ability to create chaos. We've had terrorism ever since the first slingshot pellet was thrown at, you know, the Pharaoh's agents, okay? So I want to make one final point, if I can have 3 minutes. Okay. And that is, what is to be done about this? And why we should be optimistic, and why we should be fair. I left out about 15 different points. The main rallying point we should have is that knowledge makes us stronger, okay? I know this is not as wild as, you know, workers of the world arise, but it's a compelling idea. The assertion that we have a right to know and that you should not be allowed to lie to us. So first of all, we have to celebrate and support the whistleblowers, okay? And just as Daniel Ellsberg was the most significant American of the previous 50 years because he was a truth teller and brought us the essential data, Edward Snowden is the great hero so far of this century, okay? And I say that not to get an applause line, because quite often I get booed when I say that. I say that advisedly. And that what, you know, people say, like Hillary Clinton, well, why didn't he use the channels? She knows damn well the channels don't exist and that she closed them. Give me a break. Here's a woman who does not want the government to have access to her emails, does not trust her own State Department that she has been the head of, to read her emails, but has never once expressed, while she was on the cabinet, in government, or anything else, expressed any reservation about the State Department reading the emails of the rest of us. Never. Not a word. Okay? And whether it's Republicans or Democrats, they lied about it. They lied about the extent of surveillance. They lied about their invasion of private companies when you had this one brave person up in San Francisco who wandered into the AT&T office and he said, no, they're trapping, they're getting everything. They're cutting into all the fiber optic cable and everything. He was dismissed. The ACLU wouldn't even at first defend him, okay? And if you look at the record of whistleblowers, a guy named Bill Binney, right, who worked at the NSA for 25 years, his wife worked at the NSA, he was the most brilliant cryptologist they had, and he developed a system called ThinThread that allowed you to read data and get data without being that intrusive into people's privacy, was rejected. They then get this vast system that came up with nothing and overwhelmed you with me and saying, what happened to him when he tried to go through the channels? You know, as opposed to Snowden, who had no channels because he was a contractor and the channels don't apply to him. You know, Binney was in. There were channels. He ends up being hauled out of a shower when he's naked after the FBI has come in and pointed guns at his wife and his son's head. They pull him out and they throw all these damn charges at him, none of which could stick. That's his punishment for trying to have an informed public. You know, Thomas Drake, go through the list. Again, I would point out it's a few. Why so few? And why do we question their motives rather than the people who remain silent? So I think, number one, our system is broken as far as, and when it comes to national security, classification, it is broken. You cannot get the information. I was going to read before. I won't read it now because I've taken too much time. But when I was in Vietnam, I was around there at the time of the Gulf of Tonkin incident, okay? And I believed that the second Gulf of Tonkin attack had occurred. I believed that because I thought, well, it's too hard to keep a big lie. Too many people would come forward and tell you. So many people knew, okay? 20 years later, I'm sitting at the LA Times and finally get a hold of a declassified document that's starting to come out 20 years after the fact, that there was no second Gulf of Tonkin attack. The Gulf of Tonkin attack was the basis of extending the war to Vietnam, you know, changing the whole nature of the war. I went downstairs to a wonderful human being who I still think of as a wonderful human being, Tom Johnson, our publisher. And I said, Tom, you worked in the White House, and you ended up helping run Lyndon Johnson's radio stations and everything. You're a great admirer of Lyndon. You still work with close to Lady Bird. I got these documents that say Lyndon Johnson knew in real time, an hour after the so-called attack, that there was no attack, or at least no evidence of an attack. Okay? No evidence of attack. Yet, Lyndon Johnson went on television and told the nation that we've been attacked and we have to extend this war. This was not Donald Trump. This is not Ted Cruz, right? Lyndon Johnson, you know? Just as, by the way, the person who dropped those atomic bombs, right? Killing, picked daytime time to drop those bombs when maximum number of children would be in the streets, right? The greatest act of terrorism the world has ever seen. Deliberate targeting of civilians, if that's what we mean by terrorism, is now, again, perceived as a good president. Frank Kelly actually worked for him, so we all have our contradictions. Okay, so here was the Gulf of Tonkin, and the reason I bring it up is it's a lie that continued for 20 years. And we didn't have a whistleblower to tell us the whole thing was a fraud. And we only came out after it didn't matter anymore. And when I went to see Tom Johnson, bless him, he said, well, you got to run with the story, but you know, I didn't know. And he was shocked. So what I'm saying is lying has always been the norm in the building of empire. And the lying is to such an extent about foreign affairs. I've been a local correspondent. I've written columns over there. If I write an article about, you know, why did that sewer back up? Or should we expand the highway? You'll all be expert on it in minutes. And if anybody tries to lie to you and they, oh, no, that's classified, you'll say you're full of it. You can't keep that from me. I need to know. But foreign policy, war, peace, lie with impunity. So I want to end on one final note in that regard. And that is that government lying is not only the norm, it's what classification is all about. And any journalist who tells you opposite, who has covered national security, is not telling you the truth. If they go on the Sunday morning shows or anything. And I'll give you only one example of that, okay? I was in the Center for Arms Control at Stanford when Condoleezza Rice was there and so forth. To my mind, this is really sort of a startling example, but it also goes back to our nuclear age and the reason they invited me here. And at that time, I was covering the whole Star Wars stuff. Ronald Reagan had told me about Star Wars before he announced it to the nation. I had been interviewing him for the LA Times. And so I got interested and I got permission to cover it. Edward Teller was very excited about it and all that. I went up to Livermore, I went to Los Alamos, wrote a lot of stories about it and so forth. And Star Wars, the whole notion of Star Wars defense and reintroducing nuclear war fighting, right, which came up, which was what my book was all about, was based on the idea that we had a new weapon that harnessed the power of a nuclear explosion and could send out an infinite number of rays preventing your enemy from retaliating. You know, there was no deterrent to your power. You'd have these things up there and they could explode and shoot out these things. You got lasing, okay? The question is whether you could do it technologically. And Edward Teller had convinced Ronald Reagan that they had done this. They were on the brink of it. And there was this new weaponry, and that meant you could have a defense. He never said we can now blow up the rest of the world. He said now we don't have to worry. And we don't have to do so much arms control, and we can do this. And so we were in a very dangerous period. I was living in Orange County. Unfortunately, I was imprisoned there 10 years when my wife was the editor of the LA Times. And so I got on a plane at PSA, or no, Southwest PSA. And I got on a plane, and I'm going up to Stanford to the arms control thing. And I get off the plane, and Edward Teller was on the plane. Edward Teller, I don't have to tell you who Edward Teller, father of the H-bomb. Edward, we shake hands. I'm a good guy. I like everybody I interview. And I was, oh, hey, Bob. And where are you going? Oh, I'm going up to Stanford, Sid Drell's operation, and, you know, for our biweekly meeting and everything. He said, oh, yeah, great. He says, and we're standing there, right, you know, near the Hertz thing. And Edward Teller tells me what was the most important secret in the whole world, were it true. He said, well, make sure Sid tells you about our last cottage test. We got lasing, you know? And I said, what? You know, it would mean that you harness the power of the bomb and you sent out these rays and you had the ultimate Buck Rogers weapon. He's telling me this. This commie from Berkeley, right? You know, I mean, we have no, it's not like he thought I was, you know, in his camp on everything. Well, we got along. He wanted to get the story out. And I'm there with the LA Times. And so I go up to Stanford to Galvez's house, and Sid Drell comes to meet him at the door. And I said, God, you're not going to believe this. I just ran into Teller at the airport, and he tells me that the cottage test was successful, and they got lasing. Well, I wasn't even supposed to know the cottage test had anything to do with any of this. They were named after cheeses, you know. And you're not supposed to know what it was about, and you certainly weren't know that they got this lasing, because if they did, it would be the biggest military secret in the whole world. Okay, the ultimate weapon. And so Sid Drell says, out. And we walk outside. And he said, what the hell are you talking about? You know, what is this? He's trying to set me up. I said, he was adjacent. He had access to a lot of this information. So I said, no. And what the hell told me? He said, you're going to tell me about it. He said, I'm not going to tell you about it. I'm not going to talk about this. It's, you know, top secret, blah, 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 everything. The only reason I tell you that story, because it turned out, by the way, they didn't get lazy. The president thought they did. They thought they did. But it turns out the heat from the explosion distorted the machines that were measuring the results. Okay. That no one was ever told. They didn't get it. And on that basis, we had gone Star Wars, and lots of money was spent and everything on this, and made the world a much more dangerous place. We could have had a preemptive strike before they got it, all kinds of nuttiness, death, destruction, and everything. Okay, dealing with the highest level of classification, the kind of thing that Wen-Ho Lee, a scientist, those models, not came close. Spent 9 months in solitary, you know, about any scientist who ever said anything. But here, that's the story they wanted to get out. Just like the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. Any story they want to get out, they have impunity. They can make any lie. They can tell you anything. It's classified, not true, okay? And that's so my basic point today. If you're going to build an empire, you're not going to have representative government. It's that simple. And so the goal has got to be, yes, it might be nice to reorganize the whole world. You don't have the knowledge to do it. You don't have the good intent to do it. You don't have the staying power in any serious way to do it. And you're going to fuck it up terribly, and then you're going to cover up how you fucked it up, and you're going to go and do it again. That's what it's all been about for 50 years.